It was the best of times. It was the worst of times. These famous lines with which Charles Dickens began a famous novel are words which point to something important about life. We can always look upon something from different perspectives. In one sense, almost any time can be the best of times. In another sense, that same time can be the worst of times. It depends upon the perspective you bring to it. Actually, particular situations can have many perspectives. Take our present economic climate. There is plenty to see that is negative and that is challenging. And yet, in listening to economists, there are numbers which indicate some areas of the economy are doing all right, or at least headed in the right direction. But then again, there are other perspectives beyond those economic number crunchers. Whether you have a job, for example, and how your company or your business field may be doing. If you have lost a job and are out of work, economic numbers and forecasts don't count for much. Beyond this, if you are retired, you have a different perspective than if you are about to get out of college or high school and enter the job market. And of course, your views can be shaped by whatever is going on personally in your life and in your relationships. So you get the idea. There are lots of perspectives people can have, both individually and as a society. I want today to bring a certain perspective to economic life in my sermon this morning. As a minister, I'm not here to give you investing advice or to talk about specific savings plans because, first, I'm not qualified, and second, it's not what I'm really here for. I really cannot use the Bible and Christian tradition to tell you whether to put your money in a dot-com startup or simply to put it under your mattress. I'm not here to help you with particular skills of job hunting or to espouse a particular economic philosophy. The perspective on economic life I bring this morning is a religious one, a faith perspective. What does our faith have to say in light of our present economic challenges? And even more specifically, I'm in the middle of a series about stress and living wisely with it. We've looked at stress and how we have the freedom to reconsider or to reframe our trials. We've looked at stress and how our words can perpetuate the fire of life's ongoing destructive divisions. We've looked at guilt and the stress of doing nothing about it. And last week we looked at stress and how our desires, instead of leading only to destructive conflict, can find a focus or a way through and beyond conflict. Today I invite you to think about stress and the wages of economic life from a faith perspective. When you look at our passage from James, he really has two basic themes he wants to emphasize about economic life, and they can be summed up with the two words, trust and temptation. James begins, "Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to such and such a town and spend a year there doing business and making money, yet you don't even know what tomorrow will bring. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wishes, we will live and do this and that." Now, James is not simply asking us to use different words when we talk about our economic plans. That would be silly. The words represent for James a different kind of attitude, a different kind of approach in life. Instead of relying simply and solely upon your own power, James says, look to God, who is your source. Recognize and remember that we are dependent upon God, even in the midst of our actions. So an element of trust is fundamental of trusting God ultimately with all our economic plans and hopes, let us recognize our ultimate dependence beyond ourselves, beyond our current work situation, beyond any economic system, and upon God. James then changes his emphasis from trust to temptation. Come now, you rich people, he begins as he goes through a series of warnings. Your riches, no matter how fine, will not last. You have taken advantage of the laborers upon whose backs you have built your fortunes. You have lived on earth in luxury and pleasure, but you stand judged and condemned. Beneath all these admonitions that James gives, James is warning us about a certain temptation. And it is the temptation to look upon others and all things only in terms of economics, of rich and poor, how much a person has or does not have. In giving yourself over to the pursuit of riches to such a degree that you neglect others and devalue them, James says you are in effect measuring others, all others, by their economic value alone. Now, it is interesting to read this passage and think about the temptation of measuring solely by economics in light of our current economic system of competition. There are some who say we should do away with competition, that competition itself is the source of evil. I disagree, and I think that it is more subtle than that. There are both strengths and weaknesses when it comes to competition in our economic society. Its strengths are that it gives people at its best the freedom to pursue jobs and the kinds of work they desire and to change them if they so desire. There is some element of choice when it comes to career and to work in our society. Also, the competitive interplay between people and companies creates greater variety than would otherwise be the case. Just walk in any large store sometime and notice the great variety of things that are on offer. Also, competition fuels creativity as people seek to find new and different ways, new and different things through creative development of existing products and services. All this, I know, is a basic understanding, but I think sometimes we don't realize just how amazingly creative and diverse our competitive system can be and the relative freedom that it gives to each one of us. Now, to be sure, there are also weaknesses. Our freedom doesn't always feel free when we feel stuck either in a job or without one. And the competitive attempts to get our attention through advertising with name brands in virtually every area of life these days can tempt us to define everything and everyone economically. As an aside, I wonder what we at this church, if we could get a deal with Coke, say. If we agreed to call ourselves Coca-Cola Baptist Church. And if we did that, what would it really cost us?